One of the greatest inventions of all time, in my opinion, was the invention of time. Because it's made up. Once we step out of incarnation, there is no time. There's just the eternal presence. But when we volunteer for incarnation, we have to accept these, you know, really confining little spacesuits. And there's amnesia created for us for who we really are. And we have to operate, we who are cosmic beings with a cosmic intelligence are now operating with this tiny little laptop that we carry between our ears, which is so small that we have to break up the gestalt into bite-sized pieces and process the pieces sequentially, just giving rise to the illusion of time. So we're stuck with time once we incarnate. So let's use it as an ally. And so this morning I want to give, I use a timeline from the beginning of the cosmos as we understand it, right up to our own period of time. So does everybody have an outline of the four sections of the first talk? Everybody got that? So it's basically a timeline. I want to talk about evolution in general. I want to talk about the major revolutions in the course of evolution. And then I want to talk about the importance of myth or imaginary order. So they're the four pieces that we'll cover this morning. So just a very, very brief, very quick run through the timeline of the universe in which we find ourselves as science currently understands it. So basically, the belief system is that it's 13.7 billion years of age. Now, the Big Bang is one of these science that claims to be totally rational and logical, asks us to make this extraordinary leap of faith, a belief in a miracle which is actually preposterous in size, that everything in the universe right now came from a single bang in a pinpoint, you know, of space. And they can't, they say it was, if you can accept that great miracle, we can explain everything else to you. So it's like, give us one miracle and we'll explain everything else to you. So it's a total act of faith. So all mathematical systems and all scientific models are based on postulates that cannot be proven. And my major in college was pure mathematics, and I had a double major, pure mathematics and mathematical physics. But in pure mathematics, it's based on what are called the piano postulates, P-E-A-N-O. He was an Italian mathematician in the 1500s. So you have to accept a bunch of postulates which cannot be proven. And if you accept those on faith, then you can create this extraordinary mathematical and scientific systems. So to pretend that science is a totally rational endeavor which does not ask us to make acts of faith is not true. We're being asked by the scientific model itself to accept an extraordinary, to make an extraordinary leap of faith that there was a big bang that created everything that exists in the world. And so if you accept that, let's go along with that just for the fun of it and see what happens, what transpires then. So 13.7 billion years ago, there was a bang. Nobody knows what caused it, where it happened, or who was responsible, but it happened. And the entire universe expanded, or that's the belief system at least. Very, very late in that endeavor, just 4.6 billion years ago, our solar system came into being. So there are parts of the universe which are three times older than planet Earth, and than our solar system. And presumably, you know, those were evolving in their own pace. So there are parts of the universe which, you know, in my opinion, have life forms which are much, much, much more advanced than our civilization because they've been at it three times as long. But our solar system and our planet has been around for about 4.6 billion years. And allegedly for the first 0.7 billion years of that process, there was no life. Life on planet Earth began about 3.9 billion years ago. And it's very interesting that the discoverer of the double helix, Francis Crick, you know, co-discoverer of the double helix, the DNA double helix, you know, was interviewed several years ago about how did life get to planet Earth. And he said, by directed panspermia, that life came from elsewhere in the universe. And they said to him, how could life reach planet Earth through interstellar space? You know, how could it happen? And he used the phrase directed panspermia. It came in specially designed craft that brought life down here. It wasn't just meteorites from other, you know, galaxies that impacted planet Earth and brought life with them. Francis Crick was convinced that some intelligent life form actually put spores of life from their home planets and directed them to intersect with planet Earth. And either came here on their own and harvested and planted the garden, weeded the garden, fertilized the garden and watered the garden, or else just centered in spaceships. But 3.88 billion years ago, life began on planet Earth. Now, fast forward, and less than 6 million years ago, a woman, probably someplace in East Africa, gave birth to two girls, one of whom went on to become the progenitor of chimpanzees, and the other of whom went on to be the progenitor of humans. So a single mother at some stage gave birth to two girls, and the lineages diverged less than 6 million years ago, and we get chimpanzees as one line of it, and humans are the other line. That's how recently the division has happened. Only in the last 2 million years have they been what we can identify as real hominids, or the species Homo in various kinds. Now, human beings are not the only species within the genus Homo. There are many, many different varieties of Homo. I'm not talking about gay men or women right now. I'm talking about a genus, a superfamily of species. About 500,000 years ago, 500,000 years ago, the Neanderthals came on the scene. And they were actually bigger than they had bigger brains than human beings have. They're about 10% bigger brains than humans have. And they're much, much stronger, physically much stronger. But for various reasons, they didn't thrive. About 300,000 years ago, some hominid species began to use fire for the first time ever. 200,000 years ago, Homo sapiens developed, a group of hominids called Homo sapiens, thinking beings, but they didn't have language still. They could think, but they couldn't think about thinking. So in other words, they didn't have language. They couldn't manipulate symbols in their heads and create language. 70,000 years ago then was what's sometimes called the cognitive revolution. And that was the development of Homo sapiens sapiens. Not just beings who could think, but beings who could think about thinking. Therefore, they had language for the first time. And that was a huge development. And I'll talk about that under section C here in much more detail. Just about 30,000 years ago was the extinction of the Neanderthals. So this extraordinary, you know, hominid group with whom Homo sapiens shared time, they disappeared. They go extinct about 30,000 years ago. Now the question is, did they fail to adapt to changing environmental circumstances, or did Homo sapiens wipe them out? It's a question under debate right now. 13,000 years ago was the extinction of all other humans except Homo sapiens sapiens. So even very, very recently, we've discovered other groups like the Denisovans, you know, other groups of hominids and other groups of humans, but they weren't Homo sapiens sapiens, existed as recently as 13,000 years ago, you know, competing, you know, hunters and foragers. And for some reason, about 13,000 years ago, there was a major catastrophic meteor event hit planet Earth about 13,000 years ago, giving birth to the great flood myths. And either for that reason or for other reasons or for some kind of internecine warfare, all other hominid species of the genus Homo disappeared, except Homo sapiens sapiens. About 12,000 years ago is a second great revolution, sometimes called the agricultural revolution. More correctly, it should be known as the horticultural revolution, because it was just the use of a digging stick. You didn't have mechanized plowing until about 5,000 years ago with the ox-drawn plow. But for the first time ever, we stopped being mere hunter-gatherers, just finding food where it happened upon us, and we began to domesticate and cultivate plants and animals. So that was 12,000 years ago, this agricultural revolution. Only 5,000 years ago do we have the first notion of kingdoms and the first orthography, the first written script, less than 5,000 years old. The invention of money, about 5,000 years. The invention of polytheistic religions, all about 5,000 years ago. 4,250 years ago was the very first empire. It was an empire called Akkadia, which was gave birth to the all the Semitic languages. So all of the like Aramaic and Hebrew and Arabic, they all come from the Akkadian language. So it's the first great empire, 4,250 years ago. So money was invented about 5,000 years ago, but coins came into circulation just about 2,500 years ago. And there were two major, almost global shifts happened at the same time. The first was with the evolution of the Persian Empire. And there had been many empires in between the Akkadian and the Persian. I'll talk about those. The Persians were the first group to come up with the notion of a universal political order, a belief system that there could be a political order. The phrase they used was, for the benefit of all humans. So the Persians were the first empire to think of a global kind of a political arrangement. So that was like 2,500 years ago. And at the same time, 2,500 years ago, was the first major religion to think about, the phrase that's used was, to liberate all human beings from suffering. And it was Buddhism. So just 2,500 years ago, you get the first efforts to think as a global community, both for political reasons or empirical reasons, empire reasons, or for spiritual reasons. So that marks a huge advance in the evolutionary trajectory. The notion for the first time ever that we're thinking as a global community, either politically or religiously. 2,000 years ago, you have, of course, the great avatar, Jesus of Nazareth. 1,400 years ago, you have Muhammad and Islam. Less than 500 years ago, you have a third great revolution called the scientific revolution. And this will be a huge movement from belief in kinds of mythology, stories about creation and the gods, into the realization that we don't have the answers to basic human questions, and therefore we better set about examining the evidence and the data to see if we can come up with, you know, what would be called scientific explanations. And it's the first time ever that Europeans begin to recognize planet Earth itself as something that could be conquered. And so the great expeditions begin at this stage. And 500 years ago, you have the invention of capitalism. 200 years ago, you have the second last great revolution. It's the Industrial Revolution. And this will have a huge effect. So here are some of the results. For the first time ever, family and community will be replaced by the state and by markets. And there will be mass extinction of plants and animals after the Industrial Revolution. And so we find ourselves at the present time, you know, thinking beyond the planet itself, sending explorations into outer space. And we're looking at a future of what's being called transhumanism. What comes after the human species? Evolution, obviously, is not going to stop with Homo sapiens sapiens. So what's the future going to look like as we move ahead? So that's just a very, very, very brief timeline of evolution. So the second point then I want to make just about evolution on planet Earth then, just generally, what does evolution look like? And I believe personally that it unfolds in five great stages, three of which are behind us and two of which are upon us. So I call these five. The first one is the physiosphere, where literally we're talking about a rock, the third rock from the sun in a particular solar system. So the physiosphere, physio from there, it's studied by physics. The second great movement is the biosphere, with the evolution of life. And the biosphere obviously is studied by biology. The third great movement was when you have rational animals, you know, and Homo sapiens sapiens arriving, you have what I call the psychosphere, which is studied properly by psychology. The next two, Tyler de Chardin called one of them the noosphere, a grid of consciousness surrounding the entire planet into which we're all plugged. And in some senses, the internet was the beginning of that process. But Tyler de Chardin foresaw that way back in the 30s and the 40s. So he called it the noosphere, from a Greek word meaning unity, unity mind. And the fifth stage, I believe, I'm going to call it the pneumasphere, from the Greek word pneuma, you know, meaning soul or spirit. And that's the future evolution. So that's what the five great phases look like, in my opinion. So three of them are behind us, the physiosphere, the biosphere, and the psychosphere. And we're now dealing with the noosphere, and what lies ahead of us is the pneumosphere, as far as I'm concerned. So in this movement then, some of the little steps have been single-cell creatures leading to multicellular organisms, leading to communities of multicellular organisms, leading to the great fish in the oceans, leading to amphibians who came out onto dry land, leading to reptiles and birds, leading to mammals. The mammals arrived about 250 million years ago, and they're the first creatures to have emotions, to be able to dream, and to nurture their young. So that was a huge movement in the evolutionary trajectory. Then you had the hominids arriving, then the genus Homo, then Homo sapiens, then Homo sapiens sapiens. And we're at a bifurcation point now, in my opinion. And it's going to give birth to two different... There have been many, many bifurcation points in the past. One I just mentioned is a single woman somewhere in East Africa having two children less than 6 million years ago, one of whom would be the mother of the chimpanzees eventually, and the other would be the mother of the humans eventually. So there are these great bifurcation points that happen regularly. And we're at a bifurcation point. And we're going to spin off, I believe, into two new species. And I call these Homo spiritualis, a group of hominids that realize their own divinity and the divinity of all other life forms and treat each other accordingly. And the other group I've called Homo sociopathicus. And it'll be people who continue to make war and to engage in violence. And there's a showdown upon us. And so when I talked yesterday about these two strands of DNA interweaving, that's the future that I foresee between these two different, strands of the bifurcation process. Now, the good news and the bad news is that if Homo sociopathicus even manages to create a global disaster in which all life seemingly is lost, the only thing that they can do, if it comes to that, and I'm hoping that it won't come to that, but if it were to come to that, all that would happen is that it would be the end of the third dimension. But Homo spiritualis would move into a fourth and a fifth dimension. You can call it the astral body of the planet or the soul body of the planet, but certainly the evolutionary trajectory is going to continue. The question is, will it have a concomitant physical level, or will it exist at a fifth dimension or a higher dimension? Now, it's very, very difficult for us to actually predict the future from the past. I talked yesterday about the notion of an emergent reality, that things emerge unpredictably from factors you can deal with, but until the factors are mixed together, you can't foresee what the result is going to be. And I gave you simple examples like hydrogen and oxygen existed for millions and millions of years as separate entities. But until they danced together, you could not foresee the emergence of some totally new substance that we call water. Until they come together, you could not have predicted from the existence of molecules of hydrogen and molecules of oxygen that there could be something called water. So it's very difficult to actually predict the future accurately based on just the present constituents, because you have no idea how constituents are going to mate and breed and what's going to emerge from them. We have to make our predictions very, very carefully, and realizing that we're probably not going to get it right. So that's the second point I want to make. So I want to look then at the five major revolutions I just mentioned very, very quickly, and expand on those, explicate those a little better. So depending on how much granularity you want to give to the photograph or how much specificity you want to build into it, you could say that there have been thousands of revolutions in the course of evolution. But I want to just focus on five major ones over the last just 70,000 years. And the first one has been called the cognitive revolution. 70,000 years ago, with the evolution of Homo sapiens sapiens, thinking beings who could think about thinking. And therefore, for the first time ever, we had the ability to kick around abstract concepts inside the cranium, and to kind of figure stuff out, have theories, make some kinds of predictions, analyze the data, recognize putative patterns, form hypotheses to explain the patterns, create some kinds of experiments to test our hypotheses, double check those against other people who are making the same kinds of experimentation, and come up with some kind of methods of, controlling the environments in which we find ourselves. And so what happens is that the evolution of consciousness now gives way to conscious evolution. So for the first 13.6 billion years of evolution, and particularly for the first 4.59999 billion years of evolution on planet Earth, it was a process that was being driven by consciousness itself. Consciousness was dictating what the future was going to look like. And it moved really, really slowly. But it continued to gather momentum. With the cognitive revolution, with the advent of Homo sapiens sapiens for the first time ever on planet Earth. Now, I believe it happened elsewhere long, long before. But on planet Earth, for the first time ever, you have the ability for conscious evolution, not just the evolution of consciousness, which is happening undercover, but conscious evolution, beings taking control of the further reaches of evolution. And that's where we find ourselves. We're in the position of directing the future evolution of our planet, at least our planet, and certainly the human species. Now, before the cognitive evolution, we were basically, biology was the determining factor. Now, with the cognitive evolution, we become where we had been victims of our biology and victims of our environment. We now become kind of controllers of our biology and controllers of our environment. And that's a huge responsibility. So now we invent theories and stories, and we create thesis, antithesis, you know, synthesis. So we move forward now, you know, trying to create the future of our choice. The question is, who will be the people making those choices and those decisions? And I'll talk about that in much more detail in the next two lectures, when I talk about meme makers and news makers. So that's the first great revolution I want to talk about. The second great revolution happened then about 12,000 years ago, and it's the agricultural revolution, or the horticultural revolution, where we went from being hunter-gatherers who just happened upon prey or happened upon plants to sustain ourselves into domesticating plants and domesticating animals so that we had control over our food supply. And again, like all revolutions, it's a double helix. There's a positive and there's a negative to it. So it's at this stage that we create surplus food. For the first time in human history, we've learned to produce more food than we actually needed for the day, and we learned how to store it. At the same time, we invented glazed pottery that allowed us to store food without water spoilage, that water didn't seep into the containers and destroy the grain. And we invented, you know, bungs that we put in the top of these big jars so that rodents couldn't eat it. And so now we could store food supplies for a long, long period of time. So food surplus. Now we had leisure time for the first time ever. So we invented art, and we invented science, and we invented philosophies, and we invented orthographies, ways of writing. We'd been speaking now for, you know, nearly 60,000 years. Now for the first time ever, we could visually record our conversations. Initially in cuneiform and hieroglyphics, and then with the Phoenicians, the invention of a modern alphabet of just 22 characters. So these were the great benefits to it. The downside was the evolution of elite groups, you know, kings and priests and governments that grabbed the surplus food and took control of it. So now they could dish it out to those whom they wanted, and they could punish those they wanted to punish. It was also, at this stage, it was actually tougher for commoners. So there's basically three kinds of groups of people in that society. There's the elite, aristocrats, there's the kind of the free people, and then there's the slave people. And this will be further divided into subcategories. But for common people, they actually were spending even more time producing food than the hunter-gatherers had, because the surplus was being taken by the rulers, and they were deciding to do with it what they wanted. So although the technology had arrived that allowed us to work less and eat more, the political setup was such that we actually had to work harder to eat on a daily basis. So that was the downside to it. And one of the big downsides to it was the subjugation of women, particularly as you move from horticulture to agriculture, as you move from the digging stick, where women could take part in the production of food, to the ox-drawn plow, where women couldn't take part in the production of food, because managing an ox-drawn plow was so physically demanding that women miscarried frequently. And so now women are sequestered, and their men are in charge of production, and women are now in charge exclusively of reproduction. And so women will be subjugated very significantly at this stage in human history. So that's the two sides of the agricultural revolution. And a final piece was, before the agricultural revolution, plants and animals are seen as brothers and sisters of human beings. They sit down at the same family. From the agricultural revolution on, when we learn to domesticate animals and plants, now they're property, and we have a totally different relationship to them. And so you find it written into the Bible, for instance, that when God gave Adam and Eve jurisdiction in the Garden of Eden, he uses a Hebrew word, a radah. He gave them radah over nature. And radah in Hebrew has three different meanings. It can mean to exploit, to dominate, or to be responsible for, to tend. And we've chosen, after the agricultural revolution, we chose the first two meanings. Now we have the right to exploit, you know, and control, because they're no longer brothers and sisters for us, they're just resources for us. So at this stage now, you get the first great empires coming into being after the agricultural revolution, particularly after the 5,000 years ago when the ox-drawn plow was coming into the equation. And at this stage, fewer and fewer people are beginning to control more and more of the resources. So for instance, in 2250 BC, the first empire, under a character called Sargon the Great, the empire of Akkadia, he had 1 million subjects and 5,400 soldiers. So this is a big, big change from, you know, previous times, little foraging bands of 40 or 50 warriors. By the time of Rome, so 5,500 BC, when the Roman Empire really gets going, so that's about less than 2,000 years after Sargon, who controlled 1 million people and 5,400 troops, the Roman Empire controlled 100 million subjects and had 500,000 soldiers. And again, at empire, you get the whole notion of the two strands. You get this extraordinary corruption of the Roman Empire as it, you know, ground down local populations. At the same time, you had what was called the Pax Romana. They brought some level of peace to warring tribes because they conquered everybody. And they had built these great roadways and these water systems. So again, you got the double-sided notion of revolution. Empires then migrated. There's this, and they always migrated. I think they migrate towards the west. So it starts in Akkadia, which is in the Middle East. Akkadia was overthrown eventually by the Sumerian Empire, which was overthrown by the Babylonian Empire, which was overthrown by the Assyrian Empire. Babylon came back again for a second go at it. It was finally overthrown by the Egyptian Empire, which was overthrown by the Persian Empire, which was overthrown by the Greek Empire, which was overthrown by the Roman Empire. And then you had Portugal's Empire, you had Spain's Empire, you had England's Empire, and finally you had the American Empire. So you watch it constantly migrates to the west, and it's going to keep migrating. And the next one is going to be China. And because the interesting thing is that these empires bear no allegiance to the geographical locations in which they find themselves. There's an oligarchy, in my opinion, and realize I'm stretching at this stage. There's an oligarchy that reincarnates again and again and again, and they have no allegiance to any geographical area. They have no allegiance to any nation state. They have an allegiance to being in charge and in control. And they will use whatever part of the world where they will invest in a military and make that the preeminent military of its time, and use the military as the enforcers, like a mafia group sending, you know, Luigi around with a baseball bat to break in your window if you don't pay protection money. And it's migrated, and we are the current empire. We are the current enforcers of the oligarchy for world control. And this empire will fall, and it'll probably be replaced by a Chinese one. And so unless we do something about rethinking how we do life on planet Earth. So to think about an American empire is a mistake, in the sense that it's not an empire for America. These people who run these affairs have no allegiance whatsoever to America. They're not patriotic in any sense of the word. They have allegiance to being in control. And they're so above, you know, normal viewing that we have no idea who's pulling the strings. And we're caught at a level of the game where I didn't talk about this in the afternoon, where we were invited in to fight each other, to create chaos, because you know, divide and conquer has always been the policy. I'm going to talk about this in much more detail in the afternoon, because the present political climate in our country is stinks of this endeavor on their part. More about that later today. The third great evolution is the scientific revolution. You know, happens about 500 years ago. And it's based on three great notions. The notion of progress, that things can get better and better and better. The notion of energy conversion, that you can take raw material and metabolize it into energy forms. And finally, the notion that we lived in ignorance for a long time. We had these very, very strange beliefs, you know, that the sun and the moon and the stars were personalities or gods or whatever. And now we know better because we're scientists. And we realize that when we acknowledge our ignorance, then we can now relook at the data and we can find proper solutions to our problems. And it came to a climax with a person like René Descartes, who was a very dedicated Catholic, but the notion of the slit between mind and soul. And now science has total jurisdiction over the mind, you know, and the churches have still jurisdiction over the soul. So again, you got the two strands of what technology can do for us and what technology can do to us. The fourth great revolution, just 300 years old, is the Industrial Revolution. And again, this is a double-stranded thing. As I mentioned yesterday, one of the great side effects of the Industrial Revolution was the end of slavery. It's fascinating to me that, you know, 2,000 years of Buddhism and nearly 1,800 years of Christianity did not end slavery. In fact, they condoned slavery. Even the writings of St. Paul condoned slavery. At one stage, an escaped slave called Onesimus becomes a Christian, and Paul sends him back to his owner. He says, now you've become a Christian, you're a brother to your master, but you're still a slave, go back and be his slave now in Christ. So the notion of slavery was totally condoned by the churches. It took the Industrial Revolution to end slavery. And they didn't do it for any great kind of anthropomorphic reason, they did it because they weren't needed anymore. That machines could now do what you formerly needed slaves to do. And as I mentioned last night, the average American household has about 50 slaves. If you take all the technology in your house, it's the equivalent of having 50 servants totally dedicated to you. So the Industrial Revolution got rid of slavery. So that was one great side effect of it. As I said, however, it broke up the family and it broke up the community. And it replaced it with the state and with the marketplace. It brought huge benefits, like, for instance, longevity. The greatest factor in longevity and good health on our planet was not any medical breakthroughs. It was engineering breakthroughs that came with the Industrial Revolution, primarily sanitation, clean water, you know, and sewage systems. They account for the major breakthrough in the healthcare industry. The downside of it has been the ecological disaster and the extinction of species. So now we have a global village. The question is there a global village living in unity consciousness with Christ consciousness, or is it a global village that's going to be taken over by some kind of oligarchy who will insist on creating divisions and war to keep us on edge constantly? That's the question. And the fifth great revolution, the one we stand on the brink of, is the information revolution. The internet, not just of ideas, but the internet of things, where we're all connected. The problem is, the upside is, you have access to all the information you crave. You can research any topic you wish. The downside is, there's so much garbage out there that you're in information overload. It's very difficult to figure out, you know, what is true and what is false. Another downside is that everything about you is known now. Everything about you is known now. Literally, your next refrigerator is going to be spying on you. Literally, it's going to record all your conversations. Your television set, whether you have it turned on or off, is going to be spying on your conversations. We just found out with leaks a few days ago that iPhones for the last 5 or 6 years, you know, have been programmed to record your conversations and your Macintoshes. So every time you're using a computer, somebody is gathering all of that information. There's nothing about you which is not known. Your ID is known, Your health record is known. Your bank account is known. And not only are they known, they can be hacked. With one stroke of a key, your entire bank account can be wiped out, or your access to healthcare can be wiped out. So there's the downside of the information revolution. Now, the upside, the long-term upside is this for me, that because it will no longer be possible to hold secrets from anybody, we'll get to a stage where there will be no purpose in telling lies anymore. There'll be no purpose in trying to, you know, hide anything from anybody. So in some sense, we're back where the hunter-gatherers were. When you live in a tribe of people where it's just 40 big and you're moving on a daily basis, there's no point in stealing anything from anybody. Where are you going to hide it? You can't hide it. You're moving on a regular basis. You know, the wheel hadn't yet been invented. You can't schlep the stuff around in your back. So there's no point in telling lies because you're all sleeping together on the same campfire every night, you know, and you're all carrying your entire possessions on your back. Everybody knows what you have. So there's no point in stealing and there's no point in telling lies. We're coming to a place where that's going to be true again. There will be no point in stealing anything from anybody and there'll be no point in telling lies to anybody because everything will be known. So we'll develop a telepathic ability, I'm convinced, in which the thoughts of everybody are known to everybody else. So we're moving into a space where, you know, subterfuge will be a thing of the past. So whether or not they realize it, that these people who are trying to gain control over the system and spy on us, you know, and survey us and know all our details, they're actually precipitating a revolution, in my opinion, where we're going to develop the psychic ability to be totally telepathic, and where we begin to realize there's absolutely no point in telling lies, and there's no point anymore in being violent, and there's no point anymore in stealing, because you can't hide stuff anymore from anybody. Final thing I want to mention then is section D, the imaginary order. For the longest period of time, we lived under the jurisdiction of a natural order where gravity existed. No matter where you went in the universe, if, you know, if there was a tree and an apple, it came a drift from its branches, it was going to fall down to the center of the planet. We live under a natural order where lions hunt and kill gazelle. We live in a natural order where planets orbit around, you know, suns and moons orbit around planets. That's the natural way. It's always been like that. For the first time ever, with the cognitive revolution and subsequently, we began to develop myths. And myths, and by myths, I'm not using this in a pejorative way at all. But a myth is an imagined shared belief that unites a group in a way in which the natural order never could. And I'm going to mention what some of those myths are. Believing in a common myth allows a group of disparate people who had heretofore been enemies or distrustful of each other to trust in some kind of a common belief system. I'll give you some examples then. So now, after this, after the arrival of the myth, and the myth can only come with the evolution of language and the ability to manipulate symbols and abstract concepts, only then can we dream up scenarios which have not been presented to our sensorium. Only now can we begin to fantasize and imagine things, you know, which we've never seen, you know, with our own eyes or heard with our own ears before that. Now, for this to happen, you know, we need to be able to kind of believe that somebody is telling us a truth which is bigger than my own personal experience. So I'm going to mention just two great myths that had this power to control huge masses. The first one was the 1776 BC, the Code of Hammurabi. It was the first effort on behalf of a society to create a codification of the regulations governing the behavior of a group of people. And in 300 precepts, this extraordinary leader, Hammurabi, put down 300 precepts that governed the kind of the life of his people. Now, he claimed that this code was given him by the gods. And he mentioned three gods, and you've heard these gods before if you're familiar with the Anunnaki. They were the gods of the Anunnaki, Anu, Enlil, and Marduk. And according to Hammurabi, claimed that these gods had revealed these laws to him. And therefore, these 300 laws, they had appointed Hammurabi to be the prophet and the governor. Now, by getting people to believe in that myth, for the first time ever, you were able to bring a huge group of disparate peoples together under the belief system that the gods had revealed this. And if you get tens of thousands of people believing in a myth, has an extraordinary ability to create cohesion in the group. Now, the code of Hammurabi is totally made up, like all other codes I'll mention. And basically, he claimed he got it from the gods, 300 precepts, and the gods told him that there are two genders, there are male gender and there are female gender, and each of them has three classes, superiors, commoners, and slaves. And they all have different values. And this is what the gods revealed to him, and this is what the people will now accept. And they have specific kinds of values. So for instance, a male commoner has a value of 60 shekels of silver. A female commoner has a value of 30 silver shekels, and a female slave has a value of 20 silver shekels. And so if you injure anybody, you have to repay according to their value in society. So males are more valuable than females. Superiors, commoners, and slaves all have their values. And people agree that must be the case because the gods have revealed it. And everybody gets behind it, and an entire society now acts as if this is actually the order, you know, how life is meant to be ordered and lived. And it's a shared myth. But when you get behind a shared myth with a lot of people, it's extraordinary power. We did the same thing ourselves in 1776 AD. We created a myth in Cecile's hometown, in Philadelphia, that said, we hold these truths to be self-evident. So we don't even have to prove them to you, they're self-evident, that all men are created equal. Except that's a total myth. The notion of all men being created equal is a total myth. There's no place in society where you see that being demonstrated until somebody came up with the idea, and it's a beautiful idea. But once you get a whole bunch of people getting behind the notion of human rights, it radically changes what happens in planet. But it's totally made up. There's no place else in nature where that is true, that there's an equality. It's always a structured, hierarchical, dominated system. And we came up with the notion of human rights. Human rights is a total myth. It's a myth I happen to believe in really, really strongly. It's a myth that has conferred extraordinary benefits, but it's a myth. There's absolutely no biological basis for it. But once you get behind it, it has extraordinary ability to transform. So what are some of the other great myths? Money is one of the greatest myths of all time. It is totally made up. And I'll say something else about that towards the end of this lecture. The United States of America is a total myth. A group of people got together and they declared independence from England. And they brought together representatives from 13 states who created the myth of the United States of America. And it's subsequently grown to 50 members. It is a total myth. It does not exist in reality. By reality, we mean the physical world before human beings arrived and created this fantasy. It's a beautiful fantasy. And it's a fantasy that we need to protect, really need to protect in our time. But it's totally made up. It's a total myth. But its organizing power is absolutely extraordinary. Now, the great power of a myth is that a myth cannot be undone by an individual person. An individual person can point out the United States does not exist, it's a myth. It won't get anywhere. The only way to overcome a myth like that is another myth which is more powerful and transcendent. Is there such a myth around? There is. There's the myth of a one world government. And if that takes place, it'll be the end of the United States and Ireland and Afghanistan and Libya and all the other places. The question is that a movement forward or is it a movement backwards? But if that myth gains power, it'll demolish the lesser myths. And we live at a time when we get to be the people, making some of those choices. So where do we land on that myth? Are we in favor of, many, many notions with their different languages, their different currencies, their different religious belief systems? Or do we all want to go into a blender in which we're all the same and we're all dominated by one world government? So that's the kind of myth that's a possible fit for the future. So I'd end by just a quick discussion of the notion of money. Money was invented about 5,000 years ago. It's a total myth. Before then, people traded commodities for each other. So you were hungry and I had a chicken who laid eggs. I gave you some of the eggs that I had, and you had grain that you'd grown. I needed some grain and you gave me some grain. So there was a kind of a barter system. Money got invented and it became so important and so powerful in organizing myth that it's much more important than any religion that's ever been invented. It's much more important than any empire that's ever existed. It's a universal, efficient system of mutual trust, the greatest one ever devised. It doesn't know gender, it doesn't know class, prejudice, creed, or culture. The color of your dollar, you know, is that anybody will accept your dollar. So it's the only one where people who don't trust each other's money. They don't care whether what religion you have, what politics you espouse, whether you're a terrorist, you know, or what you are. You know, if you give me $100, I'll accept it as $100, and I'll trade with it as $100. So what it does, it allows an extraordinary level of global trust to emerge. And it allows an extraordinary possibility of global manipulation and global control to emerge. And so the situation, as I understand it right now, is this. And again, I know I'm stretching at this stage. I am totally convinced that there is an oligarchy that's always existed from lifetime to lifetime, from incarnation to incarnation, who've attempted to take control of life on planet Earth. And money was one of their greatest inventions. And basically, the money of the planet at the moment is organized in a pyramid. So it starts with an organization called the Board, the Bank of International Settlements. You've probably never even heard of it, the BIS. It controls all the monies of all the national banks, which are subsidiaries of it throughout the world. It controls the International Monetary Fund, and it controls the World Bank. It dictates to the great corporations of the world, and the corporations of the world dictate to the politicians of the world, and the politicians dictate to the taxpayers. And money is literally the currency that allows that to happen. And so I'm going to paraphrase St. Paul to end this lecture this morning. St. Paul said, he didn't actually say money is the root of all evil. What he actually said was, the love of money is the root of all evil. But I'm going to modify that and say this. The myth of money is the root of all trust, and the thirst for money is the root of all war. I'm not going to overload you guys. I want you to take time out. The next lecture is at 11:30. And I want you to let that stuff in. Most of today is going to be, you know, dealing with the kind of the dark side of this double helix. Tomorrow is going to be very different. I'm going to focus totally on the light. But you can't appreciate the light until you know what the dark is. So I'm just to, you know, live with some of these ideas for, you know, the next hour. Give yourself space, talk in little groups or think on yourself, and then we'll come back at 11:30 for the next one.